I know a man named Tony Bond who was criticized for being quiet some years ago. It was a sales strategy meeting, and while Tony had his own ideas for how to proceed, he mostly listened. He was really trying to learn from other perspectives, other points of view in the room. In the wake of the meeting, though, he was called out for being passive. And this was par for the course 10 or 20 years ago. Tony recalls that competing for attention and trying to dominate the conversation was really common among his male peers and really prized. He told us, this is what he told us, the louder you can be, the more you can say, the more aggressive you can show up, the more you're valued, and the more you're recognized, Tony told us. I found this tension between who I am and what I was expected to be. Now, as a quiet man trying to be his authentic self at work, Tony was ahead of his time, really. Because in recent years, introverted men like Tony have been finding growing appreciation and success for their tendency to listen carefully, stay calm, connect with others, and think deeply about problems. Brash, more combative men have seen their cachet shrink amid a more volatile, decentralized, equity-oriented business climate. Now is really the time for quiet men. So welcome, everyone, to this conversation today about the rise of quiet men. I'm Ed Frauenheim. I'm a consultant, coach, and writer. I've co-authored 4 books on workplace culture. The latest one is Reinventing Masculinity, The Liberating Power of Compassion and Connection, co-authored with Ed Adams. Thank you, Jennifer. And I'm thrilled to be here today with another partner, my friend Jennifer Kahnweiler. Hi, Jennifer.
Hey, Ed, from across the country, my good friend Ed. And Ed and I met through Barra Kohler in a community of very strong authors. And I really have to say, as I think about my first memory of you, Ed, it's or one of my early memories when I really got to know who you were and it made sense that you studied and worked on quiet men, was I was at the top of a tower, you guys know, on one of those ropes courses, and I didn't know how I was going to get myself up, let alone down. And you stopped and didn't do the typical macho thing of try to make the fastest time or get to the top so everybody could see, and you were willing to help me, and you almost probably went down in the process, if I remember that, that scene up on that tower in Wisconsin somewhere at our retreat. So, and it's been a thrill to work with Ed. We just had an op-ed published. We've started to partner more on this topic of introversion and quiet. So we're looking at kind of the intersectionality here. And we got a lot of really interesting and good positive response. A couple of people challenged it. We're going to address that today. But we had an op-ed in the Houston Chronicle. So that's been our partnership. And I'm a speaker and a writer on introverts at work and have published 4 books with Barra Kohler, the latest being Creating Introvert-Friendly Workplaces. So what we want to do in this discussion today, and we want to hear from you too, certainly in the comments, and those of you who are watching the recording, I hope you'll also comment on LinkedIn and Facebook. But what we want to do is look at how introversion shows up in men who are quiet, and taking a look at some of the challenges they face, and why we both, Ed and I, really strongly believe that now in the workplace, quiet men with their strengths that Ed described are so needed in this climate. So we're going to make a case for that. So that's really what we're going to address. And finally, we want to also look at what each one of us can do as we take this growing movement forward. So that's it.
All right. Now, I think we wanted to address the elephant in the room.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
We have a
list of questions here. And so, yeah, let's start right out of the gate with the elephant in the room. And that really is, Ed, I'm going to ask you that question. You know, with men being still the dominant culture and still leading many of our organizations, you know, why is it that we need to even stop and take a look at this topic? What is your belief about that?
Yeah, I think it's a great point, Jennifer. And I think one of our attendees may have raised this issue in a comment to us. We're in a male-dominated business world, for sure, still. And yet, introverted men have had a hard time similar to other marginalized groups in organizations largely run by extroverted men. That is to say, the ones that are louder and more combative, the kind of men we heard in Tony's story earlier. Also, quiet men are uniquely suited to expand the conversation and amplify underrepresented voices using their superpowers of listening and connecting. So by tapping the superpowers of quiet men, organizations can experience better business results and greater inclusion.
Right. And so thank you for bringing that up. You know, I think about the fact that I had studied women and introversion, that intersection, and women have their own challenges too, that sort of have that multiplier effect. So I think we're starting now to look at how can we overlay this idea of introversion. So do you want me to share a little bit about this kind of the baseline about introversion?
Yeah, please. Yeah. Define what an introvert is for us and what are the strengths they bring to the table, Jennifer?
Sure. And I think probably the folks on this call and listening are aware that introversion is in the zeitgeist now, and thankfully so. But, you know, it really is about a couple of things real briefly. It's about where you get your energy. Are you somebody that gets your energy from within, or are you stimulated by people and places and doing and going? Now, I use the word stimulation because that's really where we've come. I'm kind of calling it, or several of us are calling it, introversion 2.0, or maybe it's even 3.0, where we're learning so much more about how the brain works, Ed, and how extroverts need more dopamine than introverts. Mm-hmm. So there's this idea of the keyword stimulation. How much stimulation do you need? And one deal breaker question I like to ask you out there, and maybe people can comment, where do you think you fall on this, on the spectrum, which in fact it is. We have people that are outliers, very extreme introverts or extroverts, but most of us are clustered more towards the middle with a slight preference towards one or the other. I actually have a new quiz on my website that gives you a quick overview. And so the deal breaker question is, when you're with people, Ed, and I'll ask you that question, when you're with people, must you have time to decompress? And you, yes, would answer now. Yes. Certainly after our planning conversations, right? For this, I need a nap after talking to Jennifer, right? And some of you might have guessed that I am extroverted, although I will maintain I've move closer to the middle, okay, over time. But if you're an extrovert, you'll typically answer, it's nice to have. I like it. You know, it's okay. But you will hear introverts not even skip a beat. And if there's introverts on the call, would you agree that that's something that you can relate to there? So those are kind of the dominant, you know, the main themes about, you know, when we're talking about sort of leveling off, what do we mean when we say introvert? That's sort of how I would throw it out there right now.
What about the strengths they bring? Can you say a bit about, especially in the work world, what the introverts offer to organizations, Jennifer?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, feel free. I usually ask groups that I'm with, say what you think the strengths are. But it's really, you mentioned, Ed, listening, engaged, deep, thoughtful listening. Deep thinkers. When that key word about deep comes up a lot, it's also deep relationships. And I think we saw that come out in the pandemic. A lot of people that had nurtured relationships, they even got deeper and were able to trust and really connect with people in meaningful ways. And so I think those are ones. Observation, being able to really, as Steve Glavisky, one of the people that we interviewed for the Introverted Leader series, he talked about, you know, connecting the dots so we have a broader worldview. And then we're really able to contribute so much more to our organization because we're listening and we're observing. And then, of course, the calmness, the humility, being humble, all of those things are so critical in addition to preparation. Introverts are prepared. And I think many of us extroverts have learned that lesson. And Steve Frisante, one of the people who signed up for this, when I wrote my last book, he says, I think you're moving more to the introvert side because I was so much more prepared for our meetings because I realized how critical that is. If we're going to be productive and innovative, we have to do the legwork ahead of our meetings, of our presentations.
Those are great, great strengths. And I see my friend Jim Young talked about being an extroverted introvert, which I think means, and correct me if I'm wrong, Jim, that you've kind of pushed yourself to be extroverted, even though you are more on the introverted side of things. And it's been hard to be around those loud men. Jennifer, maybe that's a catalyst to, you know, say, what are some of the challenges that you've seen in your research for introverts at work?
Yeah, Jim, that shuts people down, doesn't it? Big time when that happens. And I found that with women and certainly with quieter men. So a couple of the key challenges are people exhaustion related to the fact that, you know, so many of these back-to-back Zoom meetings and you know, all the stimulation that's happening, it really does create a challenge. And a lot of times I can't resist, Ed, but I have to show my t-shirt that We still have some of these available. You read my t-shirt, that's enough social interaction for one day. We ended up putting those on the back because people would come up to people and give them a hard time. So, you know, people exhaustion and negative impressions and bias. And I found that that's really critical. People are not showing much affect, as a quiet man may not be showing affect. And then all of those negative stereotypes or projections are put onto him when performance reviews come up, when people are talking about him. He's angry. He looked bored. He's slow. He doesn't have anything to share. And so those just are exponentially perpetuated and can really create a hole for men to climb out of, particularly within the workplace. So the last one I'll say came up in the last book and in the last research for the book where I looked at workplaces. And one company, a large pharmaceutical company that I went to, I kept interviewing people individually, and the word term loudership instead of leadership came up. And that seemed to be the cultural sort of like tongue-in-cheek joke, but it was really true. You didn't get promoted unless you were very loud, like you were saying Tony was pushing back against. So yeah. So I hope we have a lot more to address, but I think those are some really important ones that came up when you asked me that.
Thank you.
So yeah. So I want to ask you now, when you think of, we talked about introversion, what do you think the challenges are that men have, introverted men, particularly in the workplace? Your work is a lot about this confined masculinity. So I'd like you to talk about that. Where do you think that comes into play here?
Sure. Yeah, I think introverted men have had significant challenges at work, and you touched on some of them. And that bias toward what I've heard you say, called the extrovert ideal, is really part of a wider set of expectations for men in the world. And in this book that, you know, we've talked about Reinventing Masculinity, my co-author Ed Adams and I call that conventional masculinity, confined masculinity, as you just put it, Jennifer. Mm-hmm. And we use that term because that dominant version of masculinity really limits the roles men can play, as well as how they can relate to other people. So men are allowed to be providers, protectors, conquerors, and competitive, aggressive, stoic, but not really sanctioned to be soft-spoken, to be a great listener, to focus on connecting and building those deep relationships versus competing with other people. So given those man rules, as some people call them, quieter men have often shut down or become exhausted. You know, maybe that's what Jim was speaking to, by trying to be someone they're not. Yeah. And too often they've been written off, as you were speaking to also, Jennifer, as having nothing to say, even though they may have a lot of good ideas that are just below the surface, or they're not ready to think on their feet exactly. But if you give them a bit of time, they do have stuff to say. And I, you know, as someone who identifies as slightly on the introvert scale, I've experienced some of these challenges myself. I'm not that focused on beating others at work. I've been more interested in connecting with people. So over the years, 30 years in the work world, I've really built a lot of relationships with peers, and deep relationships with peers. I haven't necessarily been strategic about connecting with the bosses at the top, or, you know, playing that power game. And I think that's hurt my, you know, conventional success. I haven't risen up the corporate ladder. In fact, I've managed one person for one day. I may have the shortest management career on record. And yet my day is coming, maybe, you know, if we're right here, Jennifer, it's time for some of the skills that I can bring and other quiet men can bring to the table.
Yeah. And it may be that you didn't necessarily want a higher level job, but in what way do you think by you, and I think it's a real strength to build relationships, as I've experienced on the other end of that, deep relationships where you learn and you grow. But if you think back, Ed, on your career, you said not building strategic relationships, right? So do you think that might have helped you in some cases, maybe get that assignment or opportunity, you know, promotion, or you know, just a project that was really cool to work on because people didn't think of you in that way?
I think the latter. I mean, I've been able to do work that I've really loved over the years, and a lot of them have been collaborative projects with peers, newspaper article series when I was a journalist, book projects. I've always had a collaborative approach to writing books, and I've really enjoyed that. So I think there is something to what you're saying there. You know, and let's kind of take that wider perspective, and I'd love to talk, you know, hear your thoughts, Jennifer, about what is it about guys like me, you know, quieter men, that's really suited for today's business climate.
Oh gosh, yeah, Yeah. And boy, we have certainly had some challenges this past 2 years. It's a complex world. I think we both shared that when we did research for our individual books. You know, the faster, flatter global business climate that, you know, the futurists are saying, wait, you haven't seen anything yet. You know, it just keeps getting more and more fast. So there are three challenges that come to mind, really, when you think about where introverts are kind of, you know, really suited for this world that we're in, and the listening that always comes up when people talk about their favorite introverted boss or colleague. It's people like you, Ed, who listen, you know, and
what was that, Jennifer?
They listen.
Kidding.
Right away, I'm thinking technology. You can't hear me. Candace, I'm going to put Candace, my dear friend's comment up there. It is a complex world. Absolutely. So number one, listening. Most of you do, except, of course, no, I won't even go there. Interesting with the whole situation with racism that has, that we were having lots of conversations about and still are, particularly white men who are engaging in profound self-reflection regarding longstanding privilege. So I think that it's, you know, that's really required of anybody who's in the dominant part of the world, right? Or in the dominant sector where we're looking at our own bias and how we can act with integrity. And I think that introverts, men certainly are called upon that. And the second thing is the pandemic, which I alluded to. We've done quite a bit of research in my firm around how introverts have adjusted to the pandemic and how they, what they want going back. And it's overwhelmingly coming across that remote work is really suiting them. It's suiting a lot of people, but I think introverts find for the solitude, the independence, and the autonomy, the lack of interruptions, which before the pandemic, when I did surveys, that would come out typically at the top of the list. You know, I can't stand people coming by my cube or interrupting my thinking. Interruptions were a real challenge. So now I can focus. And that then, of course, in the company leads to more productivity, innovation, and people can sort of create those relationships and those connections on their own time. And then the third area, in addition to listening and the hybrid or the remote work, is connecting deeply with people right now. I mentioned deep communication that we all sort of had to figure our way through in the last 2 years and continuing on to, but we all also hearing so much about anxiety, mental health challenges, and physical challenges. And I think introverted, quieter men are more able to, because it is about humility and being humble and listening and calmness, they are able to be present for those conversations and really develop trust. And that's really important now we're seeing with senior leadership in organizations, being more transparent and connecting.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And that what I heard in some of my research is I've studied some best workplaces in particular is how valuable it is to do these check-ins, right? Like, how are you doing? How is your team doing to build that psychological safety? And introverted men are good at that, as you're saying. They're ready to connect and have a more intense relationship or a meaningful relationship with people on their team.
So yeah, and I love what Jim's saying. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but that's what extroverts do. You're used to that, right, Jim? So, but now I love what Jim says here. As a natural introvert who loves being in connection with people, Jim, you said the remote world has been a blessing to me. So you're validating, you know, what we found in our research. And so, Ed, I want to ask you, there's a lot of men out there who are starting to, come out of the closet, I should say, you know, and so one of those men, we actually highlighted in our op-ed piece, because we had seen a posting on LinkedIn where he self-identified as a introvert, and he's one of the newest billionaires. Do you know who I'm talking about?
Dharmesh Shah.
And who's
I can say a bit more about him and some of the other, let's talk about some of these men that are introverted men are taking center stage, if you will. And a number of them are getting this attention from their business success. So as Jennifer mentioned, Dharmesh called himself an introvert. He's the co-founder of HubSpot, a marketing software firm. And, you know, just because of his stock holdings in HubSpot, he saw his net worth from that stock top $1 billion. And this is how powerful his firm is operating in the world. Or if we could look at Apple CEO Tim Cook, another introvert.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In late July, Apple announced record quarterly revenue of $81.4 billion. That's just, you know, it's hard to get your head around that figure. Mm-hmm. And so he's actually managed to do a job that people thought was crazy, to try to take the step into the shoes of Steve Jobs. And yet he's done a fantastic job. And in fact, six of the top 10 companies in terms of market capitalization in the world have leaders who are men who could be described as quiet or introverted. So
say
it's
that
clearly,
number again. I'm sorry, Ed, say that number again.
Six of the 10 companies with the largest market capitalization in the world are led by men who are quiet or introverted. Mm-hmm. And those include Tim Cook of Apple, as well as Warren Buffett of Berkshire Hathaway, that conglomerate. So quiet men are onto something in the business world. And I know, Jennifer, you've interviewed a number of these quiet men in your leadership series, the Introverted Leaders Around the World. Can you highlight one or two of those?
Yeah, I would like to give a shout out to Johanna Vondeling, who's on this call, who's not a quiet man, but she's an incredibly powerful introverted leader. There are several Barrick-Kohler people who are, including a guy who took a chance on my first book proposal, and that's Steve Prasante, who I want to highlight. And also, there is a wonderful interview, and I'll put the link in the chat for the Introverted Leaders series. We also have it on my website, where one of the people I interviewed is named Ian Wilkie. Ian's in Great Britain, and he's a former partner with Ernst & Young. Ian grew up and still does have a stutter. And he ended up not only just being a super successful partner and managed hundreds of people, but he talked, when I talked with him, he talked about the fact that he valued people first. He tried to, and he got dinged for it a lot for being too compassionate sometimes, but he continued to rise in the ranks and became an incredibly, he's now a coach, but even more impressive, he started a association for stuttering around the world, 50 million voices, and has really highlighted this issue and made such an incredible difference. So we'll put the link in the notes if any of you want to check it out, because this is another sort of hidden issue that we need to address, whether it be through diversity, inclusion, and equity, or other areas. Stuttering is a big problem. But I really just, there are so many examples, and it's very gratifying to see all of the quiet men who are doing incredibly powerful acts of contributing.
Yeah, I want to give a shout out to those videos. I've seen a number of them, and they're really impressive and inspiring on Jennifer's series. And if those of you on the call here want to, you know, highlight some folks you know who are introverts, especially ones that identify themselves as introverts, mm-hmm. Mention them in the chat. And also, if you have any questions, we're going to get to more of your Q&A, your questions in a little bit here. So feel free to put some questions or comments into the chat along the way. So I think we're ready to kind of think about this sort of success factors, Jennifer, right?
Yeah, absolutely. We talked about, okay, so what are we noticing that these folks are doing to really make a difference, to create change, to provoke new ideas, to lead people in their quiet way? Because the whole idea is not to become, somebody you're not. So what paths are they forging? And Ed, in your book, Reinventing Masculinity, I was really struck by that, the model that you came up with there. And maybe you could just briefly talk about that. And what was one of those C's that we could remember or grab?
Yeah, thank you. We talked about the five C's that quiet men, as well as extroverted men, can use to become more successful and more fulfilled in their lives. And one of those, I won't go into all of them, but one of the first of these five C's is curiosity. We're talking about how it's important for men to ask more questions, to be wondering, because that often gets drilled out of us by the time we're like early adults or even teenagers. But this is an introvert superpower. This desire to study up, to get prepared, as you put it earlier, Jennifer, and to dig deeply into a problem. So quiet men, I would encourage you to lean into that superpower. And that mm-hmm. means letting the questions rip. Don't feel ashamed about appearing vulnerable and asking a question or not knowing the answer. There's a great quote from Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella that we have to move from being know-it-alls to learn-it-alls. this is what the world demands now, because there's so much new stuff happening all the time. We've got to be constantly changing our understandings. So take pride in that curiosity and keep on learning. And no, let me ask you, Jennifer, you've also got some, you know, research on this topic. Tell us about your four P's and how, you know, what we do to highlight for quiet men.
Well, the four P's are prepare, presence, push, and practice. And this was what introverted leaders told us they do to develop their leadership acumen, not to change who they are, but to really leverage and amplify that. So I think one of the ones that really fits here is the second one, which is being present. And that connects to what we've been talking about, the calmness, the listening, the quiet conversations. And I think when quiet men can leverage that, it's golden. It's golden. People feel heard. I think another example I've seen is when quiet men do presentations. Many people have the myth, well, you know, if you're quiet or introverted, you can't be a great speaker. Well, you can be an incredible speaker. And part of the reason for that is not only that you prepare, but because you are focusing on being in the moment, you are taking in the shifts, you're able to pivot, you're able to connect with people. And that's really was one of the things I didn't expect when I began this journey, but it's so it's such a learning lesson for me that being present, being in the moment, being where your feet are is critical, and quiet men are particularly attuned to doing that. So
that's what a great observation. I think one thing we had talked in the past about, Jennifer, is that sense of presence can also come through maybe in other kinds of expression, like writing, you know, and as a writer, I know I tried to adopt that philosophy, if you will, as I recently went through a health scare. I had a mild heart attack in June, and then an anxiety attack. And I tried to make sense of that by being present. What am I experiencing now? What are some of the lessons, especially around masculinity? And that led to a kind of an essay that I posted on Medium. But I think that's, again, like one thing that extroverts can be, we can show up and have good presence, not just in the verbal form or in a live event, but in the way we express ourselves, perhaps through writing or art or other kinds of ways.
Yeah, and that is one of the six strengths we identified as to how quiet men or quiet people make a difference is through writing. And I just want to give a shout out to your writing, because I think people should follow you on LinkedIn, because you post some very provocative articles. And sometimes when I read them, I go, oh my God, Ed, you're really saying that. You're so vulnerable. And you share your own story, but it helps so many other people to connect with you. So I think you're a really good example to show what a quiet man, how powerful a quiet man can be. And it's taking risks too. It shows a lot of courage. I think that's one of your—
Thank you very much.
Courage.
Well, you've been a great mentor for me and encourager. We're going to have a mutual admiration society here.
This is a pat on the back. Exactly.
Love your writing too, of course. Let me kind of jump back to then, like some more practical, a practical matter here, if I can interrupt you, be kind of semi extroverted. How can you and your organization tap the skills of quiet men? Like, in other words, what should people, you know, maybe there's leaders on the call here or people watch this, what can you do to boost your business results and get that greater inclusivity through the help of quiet men?
A couple of steps you can take. One of them is to become aware of this. Just like with introversion, the more we're aware, it's another language we have, another filter to look through, so that when we are going through our day and we're in meetings, for instance, having that awareness of, oh, there could be some introverts on the call. What can I do to just shift to make sure I'm reaching everybody? Maybe I need to do an agenda ahead of time. Maybe I need to do something in writing. You know, so once you have more education and learn about how the different styles operate, then you can flex. And I think that with our teams and as leaders, we can all do that. That's one thing that we can all do. And then I think also, I've realized this really in the past 2 years, and that's highlighting the kind of quiet men that we've been talking about. And it happened really sort of serendipitously, you know, doing all of these Zoom programs that we switched to. I came up with an idea to do fireside chats with leaders who were introverted. Most of them were men. And I would say to my client, reach for the top person, let's go to the C level. And, you know, Ed, I've shared with you, we've had CEOs of some top company CFOs who said, I would like to talk about what it's like to be an introvert and to be quiet and what struggles I've had and what I wish I knew back in the day that would have saved me a lot of pain. And here's what I would suggest you do. And I got to tell you that to me that, it's just incredibly powerful to hear from somebody at the top of your organization who's willing to say and endorsing, not just willing, but willing to be vulnerable. And number two, just by the fact that they're getting up there and speaking, no matter what size organization, it's making a statement in itself that we value these traits. And so it's been very, very gratifying. And so I think for everybody to really start to look about for those people and many of the formats in some of the larger organizations that we're seeing is now they have BRGs and employee resource groups that are organizing these types of events and sessions. And, you know, we're changing the culture one person at a time, one organization at a time.
That's great. I'd love you to talk maybe even more brass tacks in brass tacks terms, Jennifer, about how we can deal with this great resignation right now with respect to quiet men, because there's questions about retaining and recruiting. And you know, besides this idea of the awareness of the highlighting people, are there some tactical things that you've seen can work to retain and even bring in those kind of folks?
So we're talking about in hiring is one of the sort of the spectrums here that we need to take a look at, hiring and retention. Again, being aware, shifting our strategies so that when we are bringing in people, we're considering their sensibility, whether we're interviewing and not packing the day with, you know, tons of interviews or even on Zoom, whether we're looking beyond the fact that they pause, that doesn't mean they're slow, you know, so really looking at our own biases when we're recruiting. I think that's really important. I think in terms of retention, really connecting with everybody, as we go back into these hybrid workplaces, it's really important to understand what works for different people, not just from place, but time, location. And quiet men won't necessarily speak up, or introverts won't speak up. So we have to be very diligent as the leaders to really reach out to people and get their input and find out what they can specifically do.
Awesome.
There's a lot more in the books, and on the website, but I think we have to be cognizant of time. So
Yeah. And I see Johanna's raised a great question, but just on this topic of, she's blocked us off.
Sorry, I blocked you. Wait, I'll put it back there. I'm sorry, say what you were going to say.
Yeah, I think we're ready to kind of go jump into the audience questions. And I see Johanna raised a question. I want to invite Jim also to raise a comment or a question about burnout and introversion, because I know that's a topic he's studied. But why don't we tackle this first from Johanna?
Okay, so in case people are not seeing the screen, I'll read it. It says, being fully present can sometimes require a lot of emotional labor, especially in our recent challenging COVID times. People sometimes break down emotionally when they're feeling truly heard. This can be challenging and painful for the leader, especially when it's remote and we can't even offer a tissue. Good point. What advice do you have for fully present introverted leaders in terms of practicing self-care and building resilience? And I would also like to throw the question back at Johanna too, as she knows I probably would do that, of what you've learned from these experiences, right? Because you do have to manage as a quiet leader, your energy. Think about it as a glass of water, and you don't want that water to get too empty. So are you looking in terms of, and sometimes you can't really plan for when that breakdown's going to happen. But I think it doesn't really matter necessarily what you say, but the fact that you're there for them, but then also self-care, like have to take breaks, right? And it might mean shuffling around your day some to give yourself that absolute needed time to recharge, to go out and take a walk. You know, Daniel Pink writes about the research that says, if I look right now at a tree outside my window, that's going to actually change the brain chemistry, you know, in my head. So what can I do to kind of deflect that, but also still be there for people? Thank you. That's a great question, Joanna. And really, I give you a lot of a lot of kudos. I know that Bear Kohler as a culture has benefited from this caring and connection from you and from other leaders. And so I want to hear Jim's question too. Build in breaks, don't schedule intense check-ins back to back. Exactly what we were saying, Pat. Perfect.
One thing I want to add into that, I loved your response, Jennifer, and also Johanna's tactics here. I would also say that like the resilience piece, it's going to be partially a function of those moments of connection. The fact that someone breaks down emotionally when they're feeling hurt, it isn't necessarily a bad thing. It, you know, maybe a really powerful thing for the whole team or for the individual. And even if you do need to take some breaks as an introverted man leader or female leader, one of the main causes of burnout I've seen from recent studies is not feeling connected at work. So you're helping that employee feel more connected, and you're probably going to feel more connected to that person who had a emotional moment with you. You know, you might need to do the self-care like we're talking about, but this is actually probably a sign of effective leadership if you're having kind of emotional connections with people, building psychological safety, which we know is powerful.
And you said, Ed, something about, you know, how do we, with the great resignation right now, word travels fast. And so those companies that are actually focusing on the humanity, you know, that are really valuing those conversations, that's going to get out with our Gen Zs and millennials as to that's a company I want to work for. So let's put Jim's question up there, and we're going to start to wind things down. With so many people experiencing burnout, how do you see quiet men playing a role in helping alleviate burnout in their organizations? So I'm going to pitch that one to you, Ed, right now.
Yeah, I think it dovetails with what we were just talking about, that if quiet men can be, you know, encouraged to build those relationships, those deeper connections, that's one of the things that reduces burnout. Having meaningful ties to your organization and to the relationships you have at work, and also if you know, those quiet men themselves can feel less burned out if they can be themselves. You know, if they don't have to be pretending to be a loud guy, then their emotional energy can be funneled into, you know, the work they're doing and the good connections they have with other people. So I think there's, you know, they can help with the relationship piece, with the listening piece, and then also being themselves. So that reduces burnout all around and it's going to help the organization. Would you have anything to challenge or add to that, Jennifer?
Well, you know, I think that's a great answer. I what I would like to see happen now is as we move into thinking about how can we support men who are quiet, is we can all be allies for men. And I think one of the things, back to what I said earlier about being aware, one of the things I've seen happen with the introversion movement, as I'll put it, is that we have an explosion of business resource groups within organizations. And it's very exciting. So they are putting together these programs. They're validating it's okay to be quiet. I don't think we're at that stage yet. We need to get there. Where are we getting men who are talking about burnout? And it's okay to do that. With women, we've been talking about work-life balance in our women's groups in organizations. But have we really, we get an occasional man coming, but what we need to have groups for quiet men and their advocates and their allies. I think another way to do that is to have book clubs, you know, either to use our books or other books that people can get into. We've had a lot of success with that in a couple of the companies lately where it's been not as threatening. So we're not saying, you know, you need to be a quiet man, but we're saying let's consider some new provocative ideas. And so it's a little bit removed, but then people get into the personal sharing. So I'd like to recommend that you consider, whether you're in a small or large organization, just starting some discussions around this and beginning the actual formalization of maybe a group or a club and go from there.
Maybe that's a good segue to kind of what we can offer for folks who want to do this more. Jennifer, do you want to share some of what we could bring to the table?
Well, we're beginning this journey with everybody as far as really raising the awareness. And when I think about raising, I think about a rising tide, everybody goes with it, right? So all of us can be spokespeople for like making the awareness happen and making the change happen. And so, you know, Ed and I can do consulting, we can do training, we can do these facilitate discussions. And we really want to have more, as I had said earlier, quiet men. We want to highlight them. So please share with us on LinkedIn your thoughts or email us directly Your thoughts about who we can highlight. You'll take a look at our series, Introverted Leaders Around the World, that we did in our company. And then let's have one quiet men. Okay. We want to have these vibrant discussions, and that's how we get this out into the atmosphere. Was there anything else, Ed, that we had discussed as far as next steps?
Just to add that we are planning to do a new video series about quiet men, kind of tackling this intersection of introversion and masculinity more directly. Right. So that's one of the reasons why we would love to hear your suggestions or nominations for great quiet men out there.
Right. And we are thrilled that all of you took the plunge with us today and spent your precious time with us today. So we're gonna end it up right now, and the recording will be available. And please reach out to us on LinkedIn or check out our websites.
Yeah. So we're going to end first of all, I want to give my thanks to everybody who came and who's listening to the recording. Really grateful for your attention here. And we're going to end by returning to that story of Tony Bond. Because Tony is another quiet man success story. And I'm not sure if he's on the call today. He might be. He registered. But what Tony did over his career, we talked about at the beginning, getting called out for being quiet. Well, over time, he gravitated to organizations where he could be himself. And about 9 years ago, he landed a Great Place to Work. Great Place to Work, if you don't know it, is an employee experience firm, survey firm, most famous for providing the research behind the Fortune 100 Best Companies to Work For list. And Tony and I were colleagues at Great Place to Work for several years, up until about a year ago when I left to start my own consulting work. But Tony has really shined at Great Place to Work. He is Executive Vice President there, as well as Chief Innovation Officer. And in these roles, he's really been able to use his introvert superpowers, like listening, as well as thinking carefully about problems. So for example, he played a central role in facilitating internal Great Place to Work discussions to make sense of the killing of George Floyd. And externally, he's now a sought after thought leader. He does talks as well as consults on topics, including innovation, diversity and inclusion, as well as the future of work. And he tells us that a key moment for him was not giving into the pressure to change his identity as an introverted man. In the wake of that criticism he took for being passive in that sales meeting, this is what he told us. I dug my heels in and said, I don't really care what the expectation is. I'm just going to be who I am. Well, today, we aren't criticizing quiet men like Tony. We're counting on them. So thanks again, everybody, for coming. And let's keep this movement going.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thanks, Ed. It was a pleasure.
Thanks, Jennifer.
Have a great day, everyone.